There, Christine Glover here again with another author origin tag post. I found this on a video, can't even remember where, and I thought it would be fun to answer these questions. I did one a while ago that I really had fun doing, and this one is a little bit different, so I thought I'd share the answers to this particular author tag questions kind of video, just for fun, just something different so you can get to know me a little bit better. So the first question that I have is, where's your favorite place to write? Well, my favorite place to write is my office. It's really one of my primary locations for writing, for doing just about everything that I do as an author, as a publisher, because I publish a lot of my own books, as a fledgling marketer, as I like to say it. So I do love my office. I'm very fortunate. When I first started writing, I didn't have my own office. I had to sort of share space. So I used a corner in the bedroom or a corner in the living room. And the last two places, this place and the place prior to this, I have had an office, and it's sort of kind of like our little happy place. I like a nice, neat little place to work in. And my husband enjoys coming in here and visiting me, and I shared what my office looks like and my house in another video, and I'll put that link in the description so that you can see where I'm writing. The other place I really like writing is in coffee shops and meeting a friend somewhere, like my critique partner Carmen Falcone. I would meet her, say, at a Panera. We'd meet halfway and work together. Always fun. We're in a weird situation, but I do like coffee shops. I was able to meet up with a few people last year where we could just hook up, write for several hours, keep each other's computers company so that we could go, you know, take breaks and things like that. And I enjoy doing that, especially if I'm stuck. Sometimes it's good just to go to a different place, and then I'm like, I'm pretending I actually know what I'm doing, and it forces me to focus on the story. So that's my primary place, is my office, which is what I'm sitting in right now. Behind me are my bookshelves with my little happy things that I like to look at. I've got my Trello board next to me. I've got my little comfy chair with blankies and pillows and all of that. So that's my favorite place to write. Then the next question is, do you like coffee or tea? Well, the answer is both. I am an inveterate tea drinker. I love to make a good pot of loose leaf tea and share it with my daughter. I do follow a certain method of creating the tea, and we oftentimes will have that with just a little bit of nice raw sugar or some milk and sugar, and I enjoy all different flavors. I also really do like a cup of coffee, but I don't drink a whole lot of coffee. I can drink more tea than I can coffee. I drink about one cup a day, sometimes two, depending upon what's going on in the world, in my life. If I go to a coffee shop, I would of course order like a latte. I like a nice foamy cappuccino or a latte, skinny with skim milk, but definitely with caffeine. And so I'm looking forward to being able to go to a coffee shop again and order a nice fun coffee. In the meantime, I'm really lucky because I have a really cool coffee machine called an espresso, and it will make really amazing intense flavored coffee, and it'll actually foam milk for you the whole nine yards. I usually just get the Lungo, which is like a nice creamy topped kind of a coffee, and it's a special treat. So that's my go-to. Favorite book of all time? Well, I can't pick just one because I love so many different authors and so many different genres for what they are in their genres. I love cozy mysteries. I love all kinds of romances, historical, paranormal, contemporary, suspense, action, you name it, and I will read it. Except for horror, I don't read horror, but I have so many great favorite authors that there's no way I could name just one, or one book. However, I do have a favorite book from my childhood, The Secret Garden, which I just really related to the main character as a child when I was growing up, and I loved the story, and I've loved Little Princess. So The Secret Garden is definitely, it's in my special heart. The other book that I go to every year, I shared this with you during my writing reading wrap up last time, is The Interior Life by Catherine Blake. I don't know why I keep going back to that book, but I do. I'm gonna have to find another one online just to have a backup because it's falling apart. I think I found it somewhere in the 1990s. I don't even remember. So that's where I stick with my book situation. NaNoWriMo, no, don't do it. I feel like I'm always writing anyways, and I'm a fast, messy first drafters, so it's all in the revisions and the critique and the revisions based on the critique and the revisions based on the editorial that I really birth a story. So I don't like having that deadline. Plus it's in November and I want to start focusing on the holidays, Thanksgiving and Christmas and New Year's. It's all about the food for me and hanging out with my family, especially now. We are a small family, but we are a mighty family. So it's just me and my husband and my daughter this year. Last year we had like people over for the first time in forever, and it was so much fun. And I'd done some other things too with her friends, like hosted a spooky D&D one for Halloween, and we did like a raclette night with some of her friends, which is so much fun. But that can't happen this year. So it's just the three of us, and we're just going to have all our favorite foods and hang out, watch movies, and chill. So that's kind of how we're rolling. Genres I would write if I had no restrictions. Well, I'm already writing my favorite genres, contemporary romance, romantic suspense. I love stories with just a hint of intrigue and mystery. I'd have to learn how to put them together, and I'm still learning how to deal with romantic suspenses, so I think we're gonna park that idea. But if I had unlimited time, lots and lots of extra brain cells, I would take the time to learn how to do a cozy mystery. I also am exploring a women's fiction pursuit of an idea, which is maybe a one-off. I'm not sure. I think I could pull it off, but I have to take the time to sit down to really organize my thoughts about it. And that is actually something I'm going to do in December during the holidays. I'm going to pull together some things and really think long and hard about how I want to approach this women's fiction idea that I have. And my friends in the writing world have been really encouraging me to go for it. So I'm like, well, why not? You know, it could be something completely different. This is my problem. I tend to just kind of want to try new things because I like being challenged and I love learning. It's one of my top seven strengths as a person. I'm a lifelong learner and I love learning. So sometimes my love of learning new things interferes with my momentum of the other things I've already started to learn or learned. And so then I have to go back and force myself to get back into those worlds again. So it's maybe I'm a little ADD, I don't know, but I just really like learning and I like trying new things. So we'll see what happens. If I could have any superpower, what would it be? For me, it'd be either the ability to fly or the ability to teleport anywhere I wanted in the world, because I really want to see my friends and my family up in Canada again. And I want to see my friends that live all over the world who are like family to me and I adore them. And so my sister friends in Europe and in Canada and all over the United States of America. I have some very, very close friends. We both do, my husband and I, and I miss them. And so if I could just teleport into their world, social distance for a little bit, and then teleport right back, I would be in heaven. So that's kind of the superpower I want. Plus, I'd want to be able to teleport with a nice bottle of wine, you know, that kind of stuff. So yeah, that's what I'd want to do, is I'd want to be able to teleport anywhere in the world just so I could be there with my friends. Favorite author, same problem as with favorite book. I could rattle off a bunch of authors and then I'd forget some author and I'd be sad that I forgot that author. Right now, my favorite author is the books that I'm reading right now. So it's gonna be Lisa Kleypas, it's gonna be Beverly Jenkins, it's gonna be this Lisa K. Adams, it's gonna be my go-tos if I'm really wanting to go back to old school romance. The old Nora Roberts books are books that I go to over and over and over and over again because I love the way she writes. She's the first true romance author that I really fell in love with. I would go back and reread pretty much anything that Lisa Kleypas has written, anything that Beverly Jenkins has written, anything that my friends have written that I've bought and read, like Naima Simone, Pam Montevani, Carmen Falcone. I have too many author friends. I can't keep up with my TBR pile. My to-be-read pile is humongous. Like, I have more books on my e-reader than I have time to read right now. So yeah, I can't pick one, because there's just too many good ones out there. But if you have a favorite author and you want to share that author with me, please do so in the comments and I will go and look for that author and I will give that author a whirl, because I love finding and discovering new authors. So please share. And if you have a favorite book, let me know. I might go pick it up and read it too. There's just so many things to choose from right now. It's hard to keep up. The next question is, what kind of music do you listen to when you write? Well, it depends on the phase of the writing. I do, I have done playlists for my stories, for individual stories. I have a montage of writing music too, it's called, that I listen to when I'm first drafting. I listen to Spotify a lot if I just need a break, like if it's just like revision or editing other people's works. I also am an editor with Carmen Falcone and Bootcamp Edits. So I like to kind of have something in the background. I like pop, I like rock, I like country to some extent. Basically, I'm a pop rock girl, so anything that's a new hit, I'll go for it. So I really enjoy listening to music when I'm writing, and it's something that I find it makes it easier for me to get through the writing sprints that I do, because then that way it focuses me in, tunes out all the noises, tunes out all the people around here, because we are all on top of each other now. Even though we're just three people, we can make a lot of noise. So the next question is, if you could live anywhere, where would it be? Okay, so I'm selfish and I don't want to just pick one place. So I'm picking three. So the first place I'd want to be is I want a place in Europe. Specifically, I want to live in Hellevoetsluis, the Netherlands, because that's where my best friend that I've known since I was a little itty bitty person, like my mother and her mother were best friends. So we've known each other pretty much since we were toddlers. We can call ourselves besties since we're about 10 and 11 years old. So it's been a long time. We've supported each other. We've watched each other's children grow up. We have traveled together, our husbands, and have met each other. We've gone on family trips together. To me, you know, I would love to live just, you know, a walk away from Jana Marika and her family, and be able to go on their boat and have nice wines in the backyard and just chill out, maybe go on a vacation to France or to Italy or to Spain or to Greece, and just enjoy Europe, because I love Europe. I was born in the Netherlands and I love visiting Europe. I'm so glad I went in 2018. It's the last time I got to see my bestie over there, and also my niece was over there, pregnant at the time, but now she has a little boy with her husband. So it was fun to be able to go there, and you know, this just proved to me all that's happened since. If you have an opportunity to go, even if you're a little tight on money, do it, because you never know when you're gonna be able to go again, or if that opportunity is ever gonna arise again, if it's gonna be taken away from you. So no regrets there. So yeah, I would totally get a little place in Hellevoetsluis, the Netherlands. It's a little drive away from Rotterdam, and I would happily live there part of the year, and I would love it. My second place that I would wanna live is New York City. If I were rich, I'd want like a penthouse right near Broadway, right near Times Square. Like, I'd want to live like right where all the action is. I'd want to be able to go to the shows once they finally come back. I love musical theater and theater. My daughter was a huge musical theater person. She was a theater person when she was in high school. She's also still singing, and she sings beautifully, but she won't let me share her videos, which makes me sad because she's so talented. And she did not get her singing talent from me. I think she got it from my grandmother, who was a elementary school teacher, and she taught piano and she sang. And so one of the ways that my grandmother, my Oma taught my mother how to read and write when they were in concentration camps in Indonesia was through singing songs, and with very few materials. So it's just a great legacy. My grandmother, Oma, she sang until she was in her 80s, and she sang soprano, which is highly unusual. And my daughter has a beautiful voice, and I guess she got it from Oma. So things tend to skip around a little in this genetic pool, right? So yeah, I love New York. I love everything about it. And I hope one day I can go back and that it can return to a new normal, and that we can, even if I can't have a big fancy penthouse there, that I can at least go see it again and go walk in Central Park and see the museums and go visit the different cool districts and watch some new shows and just be part of the theater community there and eat delicious food and all of those things. I love New York. I can't wait to go back. I feel very fortunate that I've been able to see it several times, either in the capacity of a romance authors conference, or just with my daughter one time, with my husband and my daughter a few times. We've been very fortunate to go there. I also really like DC, so maybe I should pick a fourth place, because I love the DC area and I love everything that there is about the DC area. As far as the museums and the Smithsonian's, I have some awesome, amazing friends there. They're like family to me, and we actually do a Skype with them. Well, not Skype, but like, you know, a video chat with them, a happy hour every Thursday when we can, unless we're out and about doing something different. And it's so nice to be able to connect with them that way. Well, I want to see them in person. You know what I'm saying? Like, I want those days to come back. So it's a great place. I lived there for Fairfax, Virginia for like about 9 years, eight years, 9 years, to 1999 to 2008. So 9 years. Really, really love that area. There's just so much around there to do. So as you can tell, I'm an explorer at heart. That's another thing about me that you have probably learned. I love to travel. I love to find and discover new things. I love to be with my favorite people. And I love to eat and drink really good foods and wines and just, you know, live to the largest of, live life large. That's my motto. Quality over quantity is also my motto. I'd rather have one amazing, night out then have five kind of nights out. So that's just me. The other place that I would want to live, in all honesty, is here where I am right now, which is in Texas near Austin. That's a little city just outside of Austin, close to the hill country. I love my new home. I love living where my daughter lives, of course, because that's one of the reasons why we wanted to move here was my daughter is here and she's an only child, so I missed her. And we also really love the area. We've always loved Austin and the surrounding area. There's so much to do around here. And we actually did go on a trip into hill country, into the wine country, and we stayed at a really awesome resort in a villa that was completely COVID safe. At the end of October, we did that. And it was so much fun. It was Carter Creek Spa and Resort Winery. I will drop a link to that in my description for you if you're in the Texas area. They really know what they're doing and they're on the ball. Not everybody does, but they do, and I recommend them highly. Plus, you know, I'm writing a series where the secret headquarters are housed in wineries. So it's a research trip for me, and I, you know, that's one of the things I want to do is meld my love of wineries and wines with romantic suspense. And I created this new world, Covert Rescuers Undercover Shield, and that's what kind of informed it. I hope to do more with that later on when the world opens up a little bit more, but for right now I'm just excited to write books that are a part of a crazy secret agency world that I created. That's sort of like, I don't know, Avengers meets John Wick, but without the superpowers and a little bit less intense than John Wick. But still, if you haven't seen John Wick, you know who Keanu Reeves is. I highly recommend the movies for that alone. He's a phenomenal actor and I love him. So, and he's a good person, even better. So that's the top places I would wanna live. Hope one day I can at least visit them again. So the other thing they talked about was, they asked, what do you do when you get writer's block? Okay, so I talk a lot about this in my debut video, Bitchock, butt in chair, hands on keys. To me, there's just so many different ways that you can reboot that creative well, and I have a whole entire video about that. But for me, oftentimes it's just a change of scene, or it's go to a coffee shop if I can. It's get up, walk around, take a walk, read a book, take a break, give yourself permission not to write for a while, ask the girls in the basement to do the work for you. If I can't do X, then I'll try to do Y. Sometimes I skip ahead. I'm a skip aheader and back and forther. Like clearly, since I wrote an epilogue before I even started the story, well, I mean, I have the scene cards in my, not the scene cards yet. I have the beat sheet ready right now. And by the time this comes live, it will be almost written because I'm laying in my scene cards in Scrivener starting on Monday. And I'm looking forward to diving into a new story, hiding in my office and writing for the next 3 weeks and just worrying about nothing and just letting it all ride. I need to escape for a while. If you are looking for ways to beat writer's block, I don't know if I could say writer's block is really a thing for me because it doesn't mean you have to force the writing. I think everybody has a different way of approaching it. There's no one right solution. And quite frankly, to put amount of pressure on yourself right now during these really insane times is counterproductive, I think, because it creates resistance. So I give myself permission to do less on certain days. I give myself permission to take a break on certain days. I give myself permission to walk away from it, and that's okay because the world's still gonna keep spinning. The words are going to get written and I am gonna get them fixed and I am going to publish them, but we all have different approaches and what works for one person doesn't work for another. So I do recommend checking out Bitchock, the first video I had, because it does really show you different ways that you can approach the writing when you're stuck. But the bottom line is we're all different and unique individuals, and we all have to find our own pathway. The easiest thing I can say is if you're really super stuck, a lot of times it means, for me personally, that I'm trying too hard to drive the story versus the characters driving the story. So if I'm really, really stuck, it's because subconsciously my brain is telling me, wait a minute, you are going in totally a wrong direction. And it might still not be a perfect direction, but if I wait to do it the way that the characters are driving me. But it's easier to fix something that's almost halfway there, right? Versus something that you just wrote it because you thought you had to get 1,000 words or 2,000 or 10,000 words, however many words you think you have to get per day. I don't put those kind of quotients on myself anymore. I basically just tell myself, I got to get this book done by X day. I'll see what Scrivener tells me to do. And then I just do sprints. It's time in the chair for me right now. If I can get 4 to 6 25-minute sprints in a day, plus everything else I have to do, I think I'm doing okay. You know, for someone else, that may not be enough. They might think that I should be like getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning and writing all day and then, you know, all night. No, that's not me. I want a life, and I have a life. I have a husband that I want to spend time with. I have a daughter that I want to spend time with. I have my neighbors that I go and occasionally help out with garage babysitting with, which I have so much fun with these kids. They're great. I feel like they're like my pseudo great niece and great nephew right now, which is kind of fun to have these really nice children next door that I'm getting to know and being able to be part of that community. So to me, there's more to life than writing and publishing and editing. If I don't have that, the extras that I so cherish, like time with people, whether it's a phone call or a video call or talking outside where you're socially distanced, then I have nothing in the well to give to the story. I think, you know, you need to have experiences. So sometimes maybe the reason you're stuck is because you haven't done anything to fill your well up, your creative well. So walk away and let it be. And so that's pretty much my advice about writer's block, whatever you want to call it. If you're stuck, check out the video. If you have any suggestions yourself, send them my way. I'd love to hear them. I hope you enjoyed my little author tag and learning a little bit more about what I am like in as an author, as a writer, as a reader. And I appreciate you taking the time to listen. If you like the video, please give me a thumbs up. If you want to have more time with me a couple times a month, maybe 3 times a month, go ahead and subscribe to my channel. I try to keep these a little shorter. Sometimes they run longer. I've had a few guest authors, and I plan on doing that again in the new year when things kind of settle down a little bit. But for right now, I'm just having fun and enjoying this new adventure, being on YouTube. So have a great day. Happy writing, happy reading, and I'll see you again. Bye.